Cape York, the peninsula located in the tropical north of Queensland, is with an area of about 137,000 square kilometers, about as big as Greece, but only about 18,000 people live there. Most of them in Cooktown and Bipa, the only two bigger cities. The rest is untouched wilderness up to the northern tip of the Australian continent. A part of Australia that tourists but also locals rarely get to see because you need an all-terrain vehicle, and car rental companies usually forbid their customers to drive there because of the danger of a total loss of the vehicle. My son had bought such an off-roader during his two-year stay in Australia. A Toyota VDJ76R, the workhorse in the Australian outback. And asked me if I wanted to do this off-road tour to Cape York with him. He planned the route from Cairns to Bathurst Head via Port Douglas, Archer Point, Cooktown and Cape Flattery. From there we went on to Vipa and Penfather River in the west and then back to Chilli Beach in the east. The highlights were the Frenchman's Track and the old telegraph track until we reached the northern tip of Australia via Moutey Heads and Bermega. Back we went via Captain Billy's Landing on the only two bigger roads in Cape York, the Bermega or Northern Bypass Road and the Peninsula Development Road to Cone. From there we finally returned to Cairns via Lakeland and Port Douglas. Starting and ending point of our trip was Cairns. Since my first visit more than 30 years ago, the city has developed into an absolute tourist destination. At that time, the city had a population of about 50,000 people, today of nearly 160,000 people. At that time, there was just one main street and a few guest houses. Today, hotels and restaurants dominate the city. After all, the quiet beaches in the north, like Trinity Beach, can be reached easily by car. But because of the crowds of tourists in Cairns, we left for Cape York as soon as possible. North of Cairns in Port Douglas, we bought supplies for 5 days, because the shopping possibilities on Cape York are far apart. The first part of the trip leads over the Daintree River in Cape Tribulation to Archer Point. Behind Cape Tribulation the road ends, but the Bloomfield track starting there was still very easy to drive. Thank you. Archer Point is a bush camping site, as there are many there. Simply a place to camp without showers, toilets and kiosk. Here we learned very quickly that we have to set up the tents before nightfall and to dinner and dishes before dark. The next morning we drove for one night to Cooktown and from there onwards to Cape Flattery. Before we finally arrived at the beach, we had to cross a river where the water was already up to our engine hood. But as the car in front of us had already done it, we crossed it courageously. After that, we had to drive about 5 kilometers on a sandy dune road with the lowest tire pressure until we were finally on the beach. After another night in Cooktown, we continued north to Bathurst Head. Now on solid tracks, where sometimes a snake took a sunbath. In the evening we set up our swags at the sea a little far away from the water, but still close enough that we could see the yellow eyes of the crocs in the water at night. Unplanned, we had to change from the east to the west coast of Cape York on the next day. Our air condition was broken and we needed a mechanic. And the next one was only in Mipa. When you meet trucks, it's best to stop for a minute, because it's very dusty on the road for the next minute. Our off-road travel guide described a track to Penfather River that Google doesn't know, but we found it. First along a bauxite mine and then through bush vegetation and finally along the beach. Near us, Camp Hubert, who emigrated 60 years ago from Düsseldorf, Germany, and owns a farm in Western Australia. He told us about the old telegraph track that we wanted to drive as well. And you can still hear his Rhineland origin.
I don't to know.
Oh, yeah.
Average 6 Stunden and 40 Kilometer.
Okay, yeah. And what time? What type of surface?
It's rocky.
Yeah.
But the crossings, now you got 5-6 crossings, you got the choice. You want to go there or there. It's terrible rough.
Yeah, yeah.
Only low range in the first and second gear.
Yeah.
But first we went east again to Chilli Beach, which some consider to be the most beautiful beach in Australia. On the way there we stopped at Wenlock, or formerly Batavia Goldfields. Since 150 years the machines of the prospectors are left here and get rusty. In the evening, we had found a place to camp at Pasco River, built up the swags and just ate, when we saw smoke suddenly. 10 minutes later, flames in the darkness. A bushfire that caused us to pack everything up quickly and spend the rest of the night 40 kilometers away on the road. In the Aboriginal community Lockhart River, we were able to supplement our supplies, but there was no beer. Even the transport of alcohol in a car is forbidden there. At Chilli Beach we were lucky. There was no cold wind from the sea that evening, as it is very often the case. And the beach had been cleaned shortly before from garbage and plastic, which is washed up here from Asia. By the way, Restoration Island is very near here, where Captain Blight dared to go ashore for the first time after the mutiny on the Bounty. But there was no time for history. The next day, the first real challenge for us and the car should come. The Frenchman's Track. Originally, it was built as a shortcut to the Batavia goldfields. The first part consisted of only sandy and rocky ground with deep potholes. One had to be careful not to touch down with a car. But soon we arrived at the crossing of the Pasco River. At this point it is deep and uneven with a rocky bottom. And the exit to the west is deep and stony. We crossed it several times on foot to find the best way. I had advised my son to speed up just before the exit, so as not to slip with the wet tires on the stones. But what does he do? Brakes before the exit. When I put the camera away, I saw why. Oncoming traffic, at the worst place. Well, when the other car was down, he made it and was rightly proud. The Venlock River later was rather a small thing. And also the slope from the river valley was quite manageable. On the main road we inflated the car tires again and we wrote our names on the national park sign. Then we drove the last 65 km this day over a dusty road to Bramble Station. The Last Roadhouse Before the Old Telegraph Track. For the 160 km long Old Telegraph Track, we had planned 2 days with one overnight stay, but you can also take a good 4-day trip there. After a good breakfast in the roadhouse, we went on the track with a total of 23 river crossings. Some of them had nice names like Mistake Creek, Cannibal Creek or Gunshot Creek. It's astonishing how many Australians drive through here with caravan trailers. The Gunshot, where it goes down almost 90 degrees steeply into the water, we drove around on the chicken track. The car should finally still hold a little bit longer. In the afternoon, a refreshing swim under the waterfall at the Footbed Falls. With other campers, we spent the night at Kendall Creek. The next morning, the neighbor called his children back from the bush behind our car. There was a brown snake, he said, which we didn't see. But we found one of the old telegraph poles that gave the track its name and connected Bamega at the northern tip with the rest of Australia from 1887 to 1987. After a bath in the Elliot Falls, we returned to the track. The next minutes, I'll just let our ride on the old telegraph track works its magic on you. Also, the bridge doesn't really inspire confidence. Turning back is out of the question. Well, it worked. At the penultimate river, Nolan's broke, the car got stuck in the morning. Engine broken and the whole interior wet, including camera equipment. Therefore, each further vehicle was secured with a tow rope by twos who camped on the other riverbank.
Have you got a shotgun? What channel you on? What channel you on?
16.
The security vehicle and my son agreed on a radio channel. Done. We did the OTT. Only our exhaust pipe was broken, because we had put somewhere on a rock, and we had to turn up it now with a pair of pliers. Soon we arrived at the Jardin River. Also, it is only about 130 meters wide and not too deep. It is not allowed to cross it by car for some years because of the crocodiles. However, the 3-minute crossing by ferry costs $90. A proud price that many Australians complain about. Up to our destination of the day, Moody Heads, it was now only a short distance, on which we met an Australian from Brisbane who made the tour to the Cape by bike. Also in Moody Heads we had a beautiful bush camping site at the sea only for us. Unfortunately, our camping toilet was useless because we would have to take the plastic bags with us to the next village. Via Bemaga, we drove to Zeysha and camped there for 4 nights on a camping site. From there, we explored the northern tip of Australia. With 1,000 inhabitants, Bamega is the only bigger village on the northern peninsula area and looks manageable also by the drone camera. The only sightseeing are 2 airplanes that crashed during the war there. Also, the airport of today is rather clear. Our camping site in Zeysha was directly at the sea. But here nobody swims because of the crocs. And everywhere there are hints for the anglers to dispose the waste in lockable containers. Halfway to the tip we visited the Croc Tent, a souvenir shop that is open seasonally. Opposite, Lockerbie Station, a cattle farm abandoned in 1975. Through the rainforest we continued to the Cape. From the parking lot you have to walk about 15 minutes over a hill to the northernmost point of the Australian continent. We hadn't expected that and wore only our thongs, our flip-flops. But the way was worth it, even in not so good weather. Back we drove through the rainforest to the Cape York Wilderness Lodge. It was built in 1986 as a 5-star resort for $1.2 million. By Bush Pilot Airways. Later went to Ansett Australia, then to Qantas, and finally to the Ingenio Aboriginal Corporation. Until 2002 it operated under the name Pachinka Wilderness Lodge. A renovation and reopening in 2003 no longer took place, poor management as it is called. Meanwhile, the rainforest has reclaimed the 14 square kilometer site. The last excursion in the far north led us to the eastern part, the 5 beach run. On the beaches along the water, in between overland. At the northern end of this track, Somerset Homestead was located, a farm founded in 1863. But even that is now long history. So there is left only a campsite on the local Aborigine community. Because of a rainy day we made a boat trip from Zeysha to Thursday Island, one of the 4 islands in the Torres Strait, which Captain Blight from the Bounty passed on his way north and named it after the weekdays of his passage Tuesday to Friday. There wasn't much to see there, but the island is certainly a quiet retirement area. On the way back, we took the ferry across the Jardine River. And via the Northern Bypass Road, we headed for the bush camping at Captain Billy's Landing. We were lucky to get to the ferry early. Behind us, a long queue of waiting cars. At Captain Billy's Landing, we had a whole bay to ourselves for one night. This time even with a bush toilet. It is a blue cottage in the back of the picture. The next day, the Peninsula Development Road to Cohn was heavily corrugated, and we had to find the right speed to get over smoothly as possible. Also, there is a lot of watering. It's better to keep a little distance from the needles in front because of the dust. Unfortunately, the gasket of the differential at the front axle of the car was damaged by the bumps, so that we could not drive a planned last track anymore. Our campground near Cohn in a small wood. South of Cohn, the sealed road started again. Our last campground on this off-road trip we found at the site for road construction material near Lakeland, right next to the road. From Lakeland to Cairns, I was allowed to drive again. It is a normal highway without off-road challenges. Boring, said my son, and he gladly left the steering wheel to me. Between Port Douglas and Cairns, another beautiful stretch directly along the Pacific Ocean. Finally back in the civilization of the city of Cairns. This is what a car looks like after 3 weeks in the Australian outback. And not only outside, but unfortunately also inside. On our question, how best to get it all clean again, an Australian laughing, 10 years of cleaning the car every Saturday, then it looks like new. Next morning, the view from the hotel window was a bit strange. On my departure day of the flight back home to Germany, still another short excursion to Kuranda, north of Cairns, near the airport. Much too fast, our off-road adventure in the untouched wilderness of Cape York was over. But we still decided to bring this great car to Germany. So in 2018, I drove it from Siberia via Mongolia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan and the Caucasus to Europe. But that's another story.